through 41. If I can find it. Ah, here we are. And as evening came, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let's cross to the other side of the lake." That means through the middle. So they took Jesus in the boat and started out, leaving the crowd behind them, although other boats followed. But soon a fierce storm came up. High winds were breaking into the boat, and it began to fill with water. Jesus was dead asleep in the back of the boat with his head on a cushion. And the disciples woke him shouting, "Teacher, do you not care that we're going to drown?" And when Jesus woke up, he rebuked the wind and the waves. "Silence, be still." And suddenly the wind stopped and there was a great calm. Then he asked them, "Why are you afraid? Do you still not have faith?" And the disciples were absolutely terrified. "Who is this guy?" they asked each other. "Even the wind and waves obey him." Now, what kind of things stress you out? What kind of things really start to get you on edge? What kind of things? Politics, all right. Yeah. That was a really quick word. All right, family, kids, yeah. Ooh, I feel that one. I feel that one. What else? Work, okay, yeah. And politics again, okay, yeah. How about, any of you guys ever get a letter from the IRS? Just the letterhead starts to stress us out, right? Any of you had to have prep for a colonoscopy? Yeah. How about following GPS? I have a story to tell. Yeah, you knew it was coming. On the way home from vacation, we stopped in North Carolina, and then Lloyd and I were going to go from North Carolina to somewhere outside of Harrisburg, PA, actually about an hour south of Harrisburg. So put the GPS on too, because we made some reservations at a hotel, and we had points that basically my sister gave me, and points, anyway, we had points, and so we were going to stay at a halfway decent, nice hotel. And I'm like, oh, yeah. So it's really easy. It's like a 7-hour drive up to there, and then we'll take another 7 hours or 8 hours back to Vermont. And so we were driving, and we get to the location, and it is not the location. And comes to find out, the real location was an hour behind us. And Lloyd is like, "What did you do?" And I'm like, "I have no idea. I put in, okay, the devil put in a false address," because I couldn't have done that myself. So somehow I put in the wrong address. And we're driving an hour north of the location. So she's starting to get really annoyed with me. And I'm like, "Oh, I'm not heading back an hour." So I call up the hotel, and they're like, "Well, there's nothing we can do. You made this online." So then I had to call. So I'm at the wrong hotel, making calls to try to change the reservation online, because I just did it like 2 hours before, whenever it was. And so they finally get it, and then like, "Okay, no problem. It's a little bit lesser, but it's still part of the network, and it's right in your neighborhood." Neighborhood, okay? So, oh my gosh. So we hit Harrisburg in the middle of rush hour, and it's like the GPS says something about rerouting us because of the traffic. So it's like we see the road going toward where we're supposed to, but it's routing us a separate way. So it's like, well, of course the GPS is smarter. And so we take that route and we start going in circles. And Lloyd is getting really annoyed, and I'm getting annoyed, and I'm, because I know this is all my fault. And then I'm going to get, I get, start to get back on the highway that we're supposed to be on. She goes, no, not this way. This one's really crowded. And then we get off of that and we start to go in circles again. And now the blame has shifted from me to her. So now you see our tensions are rising. Now I'm like, I can't believe you convinced me. Okay, because it's not my fault that I listened to her, right? Now you convinced me to go around in circles. And so I'm agitated. She's agitated. We're agitated. And finally, we get in the traffic, and like, it takes us like an extra 10 minutes. We clear traffic, we get to the hotel, and it's like we've wasted about 45 minutes trying to find this ridiculous place. And we take a deep breath, we eat dinner, and we are all just fine and dandy. Nothing, no harm, no foul, but we are extremely agitated. So we drank. No, I'm just kidding. We relaxed. And it was like, you know, there was really not a problem. But it really stressed us out. And you know how it is, because stress turns to anger, because there's got to be someone at fault that's not the phone, because the phone won't feel my stress right now. And I think this is how the disciples felt. The disciples have been dealing with people all day long. Jesus is the healer. He's the gentle healer, but he's out there, and Jesus is healing people. He's feeding people. He's helping people. And they are the ones who are trying to herd all these people, trying to get it organized. And if you've been around people, if you've ever worked anything in customer service, you know that people, when they're irritated, can be mean. Even when they're seeking help. So you know the disciples are dealing with all these people. They're agitated. They're annoyed. And then Jesus says, I want to cross. Now, the Hebrew people were not seafarers. They weren't like the Mesopotamians. These people like to stay close to the shore. That's kind of how I am. I don't want to go on a cruise that's out in the ocean somewhere. I want to go on a lake cruise where if something happens, I can swim to shore, okay? That's my thinking. So they're crossed because Jesus tells them, and he's like, well, he's Jesus. So we're listening to Jesus, so they're crossing in the middle, the deep, the dark water, which terrified them. So they're already annoyed. They're already agitated. Now they're afraid, and now a storm comes, and they're like, I knew it! I knew it, Jesus, you see? And they say, you see Jesus? And Jesus, the waves are coming over. It says he's on a cushion. I don't know if he's wrapped up. I don't know what it is, but the water is hitting him, and it's not phasing him. He is dead to the world. He's dreaming about heaven or something where he was enjoying paradise before he came down, right? So he's just sound asleep, and they're starting to yell at him. They're like, what? And they finally wake him up out of a dead asleep. And Jesus is probably a little annoyed himself by now. And so he's like, all right, chill out. And everything just calms. And he looks at him, he goes, do you not have faith? All that you've seen, do you really need me to do a miracle right now? You don't think I'm going to let you get from point A to point B? Come on, I'm with you. Then he rebukes them. And I'm thinking, how many times that I do the same thing? I get so easily annoyed with certain things, and I have such great patience with others. I told Lloyd on that trip, I was like, have you been praying for patience? Because every time we pray for patience, this is how God repays it. He teaches you patience through anxiety. I said, I know, I quit praying for it. I couldn't handle it anymore. My patience ran out. I really stopped for a while. I was like, God, I don't want patience right now. Can't handle it. But this is the thing about our relationship with God. We are always learning. We are always growing. That's his desire for us. Well, our desire for us is we want things now. We want things right. We want things proper. We want things the way we want things. And God says to us, that's not how it works. I've got all of these, my children. Some of them are your spouses. Some of them are your children. Some of them are our spouses. Some of them are, you know, our family, our coworkers, all those people, all those situations that stress us out, they're all part of God's creation, right? Except for GPS. I think that was the devil. No, seriously, though. In all of those things that get into our lives, God is promising he's going to work this out for our good. He promises that. All things work together for good to those who love God. You see, the caveat there is that we have to be mindful of God for things to work out right, because if we're not mindful of God, we do things our way. And when we do things our way, things get messy. Now, when I look back on that, I was like, I don't understand how I messed up. And as I was thinking back, I was like, oh, that's right. You see, because I was planning to double check the address once we made confirmed reservations, and it totally slipped my mind. So, and I really don't know where the other address, how that got into my list of previous, is because I've never been to this place before. But somehow I must have been looking at it and thinking about it or whatever, but either way, it was just something that I had forgotten about. And since I forgot about it, it became my fault. And if it's the only thing worse than someone else's fault is when it's my fault. You see, because I don't want anyone to be able to blame me for something stupid and start telling stories about how dumb I was. You wouldn't believe what Mike did. Don't tell people how stupid I am, please. You see, but that's what happens. You see, because our pride gets involved, our ego gets involved, all kinds of things in our own self gets involved in our lives as we continue to do things our way. And God's like, I need you to stop doing things this way. I need you to confer with me first. Maybe your way is the right way. But talk to me first, and I will direct you. I will show you. I promise you, have faith that I love you more than you can ever imagine or think. And the plan that I have for you is perfect for you. It's good for you, even though it gets ugly at times. And the waves come through, and the storm is brewing, and water's coming in, and it's terrifying. And God's like, listen, I've got a plan. Just trust me on this. I am working through the people that are driving you nuts. I'm working through them, not only to build them, but I'm also building you. God has the amazing ability to, in any situation where, especially when it's not working the way you want it to be affecting all kinds of lives and affecting them ultimately in a positive direction, even though currently it's not. And God's like, you have to trust me, though. And this is a difficult, difficult thing to do, is to trust God, the invisible, the almighty, but he's invisible. And he doesn't ever speak to me audibly. I've never heard a voice. Well, I've heard voices that I assume was outside my house. But just in case, I exercise them. You know. Have you ever been scared in home? Never mind. I won't go down that rabbit hole. Always, though, always there's that little voice inside of me that I sometimes don't listen to. The voice of God. Sometimes I call it my gut, but I really believe it's the Holy Spirit, right, who's nudging and who's directing. And it just happened the other day where I ended up talking to someone, and it just was this amazing conversation I had with someone when I really didn't feel like doing that. It was just this nudge, just talking. It's like, man, I'm busy. And I went ahead and I listened to that voice of God, and it just was this really cool experience. And God's like, I want to rule in your life even when you don't hear me. I want you to be conscious of me, because I want to make sure that you get to the other side. You are going to get to the other side. Just trust me. Believe that I'm with you And trust me, you will get through it. But you have to love God in order to call on him. He's not just some absentee dad who has a lot of money who simply wants to give you things to get you, you know, off his back. That's not how God functions. He doesn't just give you something to shut you up. No, he wants a relationship. And he's saying, I want you to love me, and I want to show you love back. There's this relationship, and if you want to get things right in your life, in the life of your family, a life of your friends, a life at your work, love me most. And we will work this out. I will show you. There are times when things can be terrifying, and times when things can be incredibly difficult, and there are times when things are fantastic. I'm always going to God when things are terrible. So when things are fantastic, that I tend to be like, well, I guess I don't really need God today. Things are fantastic. And then it starts to go down. God's like, no. I'm not making you a spoiled brat. I want you to be someone who's always grateful and searching. All right, you guys have any questions? Pretty straightforward sermon, right? Trust God? You sure? No questions. All right. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for your love. Thank you for promising, as we confer with you, as we include you in our life, that you will make sure that we get across the lake, the sea, the storm. That you love us more than we could ever imagine or think. You love our children, you love our spouses, you love our significant others, you love our coworkers, you love all those people more than we could ever love them. And you always want what's best for all of us. So I just pray that you'd help us to grow our trust. I don't need any more patience, Lord, but grow my trust. You know I'm kidding. Thank you, Lord. In Christ's name, amen.